Exploring space has always been a nationally funded endeavor. Until now. Suddenly, it's private companies at the forefront to conquer the universe. They are popping up all over the world. Are we about to witness a new era of space exploration? Let's look into what is changing and how the space business is working with private money. On May 30th, 2020, the Falcon 9 rocket launched the space capsule Crew Dragon with two astronauts on board. One day later, the two men safely docked onto the International Space Station, where they stayed for 11 days and then were safely returned to Earth. Though flying to the ISS and returning has become routine in recent years, this was no ordinary feat. Actually, this flight was groundbreaking for two reasons. First, it gave back to the United States the capability to send people to space on their own. Since 2011, when the shuttle program was axed, American astronauts have been relying on none other than Russia to get to the ISS. Secondly, this flight was an economic revolution. For the first time in history, a private company was taking astronauts to the ISS and safely returning them to Earth. The company? SpaceX. And the revolutionary behind it was serial entrepreneur and billionaire Elon Musk. But how did this actually happen? SpaceX is part of NASA's Commercial Crew Program, the latest push from the space agency to engage private companies and create a market that is not totally dependent on federal investment. Owning the rocket and the capsule, SpaceX can, in theory, fly whoever is interested and can afford it. The ultimate goal is to transform NASA from a provider into a normal client who pays for the seats on space flights like everybody else. In an analogy to the airline market, NASA would buy a ticket without owning the planes anymore. With several companies competing against each other, the space agency would be able to purchase seats for a cheaper price than if it had to invest in development of spacecrafts and be responsible for the whole process. The cost reduction was already obvious on this premier private mission. The estimated price tag for a seat on the Crew Dragon, $55 million, compared to previous space adventure costs, we're talking cheap. One could say, revolutionary. To understand how we got to this historic moment, we need to look back into the past. More precisely, to 1982, when the first successful launch of a commercial rocket in the United States took place. The Conestoga rocket was developed by a Texan company named Space Services, but the authorization procedure back then was so bureaucratic, therefore way too time-consuming. Legislation had to be changed. That same year, then-US President Ronald Reagan made it clear that private sector involvement in civil space activities should be a national goal. US Congress would uphold this ambition in October 1984, when the Commercial Space Launch Act confirmed and expanded the government's intention of allowing private companies into the space industry game. Unfortunately, US firms remained largely uninterested in offering commercial launch services. At that time, it was impossible to compete with NASA's own shuttle program, which provided the same services. As a result, the US government limited NASA's role providing commercial launches that required the shuttle's unique capabilities. Still, the private sector's ambition to put efforts in the business didn't pick up and was close to non-existent. A new government policy in 1988 permanently changed the playing field. It forced US government agencies to purchase launch services from commercial companies. Et voilà! In March 1989, Space Service Inc. sent the first scientific payload on a suborbital trip, and the nucleus of an idea formed for a commercial launch services industry. In the following years, the market developed further, thanks mainly to the satellite industry and public investment. Between 2006 and 2013, NASA rewarded three companies with contracts to develop commercial vehicles to ferry cargo to and from low-orbit Earth, freeing up NASA resources to develop the next-generation spacecraft for this purpose. The result was, in fact, a new space race, but this time among companies in the private sector. Elon Musk's SpaceX was the first company to get one of the contracts. On May 5, 2012, SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket delivered payload to the ISS and returned to Earth for the first time. To make the mission happen, NASA's contract gave SpaceX $396 million, and the company also raised $450 million from different investors. The second company awarded with a similar contract was rocket plane Kistler, but unlike SpaceX, it was unable to raise additional funds to finish the project, so NASA canceled the contract in October 2007. 3 years later, the company filed for bankruptcy. A company called Orbital Sciences Corp. replaced rocket plane Kistler, which in 2013 became the second company to deliver payload to the ISS. In 2014, the Orbital merged with Alliant Tech Systems, and in 2018 was bought by Northrop Grumman, which to this day still delivers payload for NASA. Following the competition to deliver the first payload to and from the ISS, the most pressing question was, who will actually succeed first in sending astronauts to the space station? For this mission, NASA awarded contracts to SpaceX and Boeing. Through NASA's Commercial Crew Program, the company founded by Elon Musk received $2.5 billion, while Boeing, a traditional NASA partner, got $4.5 billion. Yep, for the same mission. The discrepancy of values was so big that Musk, like always, even protested on Twitter when the amounts were made public. "This doesn't seem right," he wrote on his page. Despite the difference in the contract, SpaceX once again won the race, and after successfully concluding the last test flight in May 2020, was certified for operational missions to the space station. And the next race is on. NASA is using the same kind of partnership to develop its human landing systems. As part of the Artemis program, with plans to bring astronauts to the moon by 2024, the agency awarded contracts to SpaceX, Dynetics, and Blue Origin to develop the next moon lander. Blue Origin is the company created by Jeff Bezos, Amazon's founder, and is becoming a bigger player in this market, not only thanks to NASA's contract, but also due to Bezos' private fortune. The billionaire sells the equivalent of $1 billion on Amazon stock every year to invest in the company. But the success of companies like SpaceX and Blue Origin and its founders are the most noted accomplishments within the market of space companies that have seen growing investments in the last years. In 2019, investment in startup space ventures totaled $5.7 billion, about $2.2 billion more than the year before. As expected, most of this went to SpaceX and Blue Origin. In total, there were 135 startup space ventures that received investments in 2019, an increase of 34% from the year before. Okay, so it looks like investors think they can join the bandwagon of big bucks up for grabs in companies dedicated to space exploration. But how much is this market actually worth? In 2019, the global space economy reached an estimated $366 billion. The majority of this includes the satellite industry, responsible for $253.3 billion of the pie. That comprises television services, navigation devices, satellite manufacturing, satellite launches, among other services. The remaining $95 billion represents the non-satellite industry, most of it still coming from government budgets, more than half of that amount from the United States. In 2019, there were 102 orbital launches in the world, with only 16 of those launches from private companies. But the SpaceX feat can pave the way for more companies to do the same, and the prospects are looking pretty good. According to estimates made by investment bank UBS, the space market has potential to grow almost threefold by 2040, reaching $926 billion. Ground equipment could be responsible for 331 of this total, satellite internet for 300 billion, consumer TV for $98 billion, government contracts for $68 billion, and a remaining $130 billion for various other projects. What other activities can we expect? One of the most anticipated is space tourism. Dennis Tito, the first space tourist able to fund his own trip, paid $20 million to fly to the ISS in 2001. The race now is to see which company will be able to offer safe and affordable prices. But the truth is, it's not looking good for the average earner in the near future. Virgin Galactic, for example, is already accepting reservations for its low orbital flight, Those able to pay $250,000 up front can secure their spot. The company has already successfully completed 2 test flights, and there is one expected in October 2020. If the next 2 test flights succeed, Virgin announced that the founder, Richard Branson, will be next on board sometime in the first quarter of 2021. Although Branson's company recently received large investments, it lost $60 million in the first quarter of 2020, down from the $73 million net loss it suffered in 2019. The plans for space tourism are not only part of Virgin's strategy. SpaceX, for example, already announced a deal with Virginia-based company Space Adventures to fly 4 space tourists on the Crew Dragon. The flight is expected to take off sometime in late 2021. Blue Origin also has the same ambitions and plans to start putting tourists in orbit in the next years. Because it will probably take some time for these companies to get any returns on their investments, tickets will most likely be very expensive, at least initially. So, just like in the beginnings of commercial airline flights, space travel will be reserved for the wealthiest among us. And here we are, another space race. This time to see which company will be able to offer the safest, most affordable tickets to space tourists. But that's not the only ongoing race. Some companies are also targeting the resources from out of Earth. According to a Goldman Sachs report, one asteroid the size of a football field could be a source of $25 to $50 billion worth of platinum, for example. Interesting to note, this amount of platinum would actually crash the market for the mineral on Earth. But exploring resources from outer space is not science fiction anymore. The main objective of NASA's Artemis project is to create a base on the moon where people would be able to learn how to live in space, training for the next big goal, landing on Mars. For that, astronauts must learn how to identify and explore the resources available on the moon. The Japanese startup iSpace is also looking into this possibility. The company, which raised $28 million in Series B funding in August 2020, plans to use rovers to map and identify water and other natural resources on the moon. The first iSpace mission is planned for 2022. And the second for 2023. And besides looking for resources on the moon, the company also plans to profit from ad space, offering companies to put their logos on its spacecraft and rovers. With so much money in the game, it's natural that investors are channeling financial resources into the sector. But are we really about to see a new era of space exploration? After years of low-orbit flights and missions to the ISS financed by state agencies, the signs of change are visible. Although a lot still needs to happen, one thing is certain. The protagonism of government space agencies seem to be shifting. The venture capital and billionaires are stepping in, and a new era is likely shaping up before our eyes. That's it for this video. We hope you enjoyed learning more about the money behind the space private companies. Since you made it to the end, stick around. Click into our other videos and keep watching.